The Apostle Paul told people the good news about Jesus wherever he went. When he returned to Jerusalem, the believers were glad to see him. But many Jews did not like that Paul taught people they don't have to follow Jewish laws to be saved. So these Jews made a plan to stop Paul. Paul was at the temple when a crowd of people dragged him away and tried to kill him. But a Roman official came and stopped them. The official arrested Paul and brought him to the Sanhedrin, a powerful group of Jewish priests and other leaders. Their job was to decide if a person had broken a Jewish law, and if so, to decide how that person should be punished. Paul stood in front of the Sanhedrin and looked the men in the eyes. "Friends," he said, "I have done what God wants me to do. I do not believe I have done anything wrong." Paul explained that he had been arrested because he taught that Jesus' resurrection gave hope that we all can be resurrected. The men in the Sanhedrin began arguing. Some of them thought dead people would be resurrected at the end of time, and others thought that would not happen. The Roman soldiers took Paul away to keep him safe. The next night, the Lord stood by Paul and gave him an incredible message. "Have courage," he said. "You told about me in Jerusalem. I want you to tell about me in Rome too." In the morning, a group of Jews got together and made a plan to kill Paul. They promised to not eat or drink until Paul was dead. These men told the Jewish leaders about their plan. Paul's nephew overheard this evil plan. He hurried to tell Paul what was going on. Paul told his nephew to report it to the commander. The army commander said, "Don't tell anyone that you told me about this plan." Then the commander told two of his officers to get together a large group of soldiers and horses. They brought a horse for Paul to ride on, and that night, the soldiers took Paul to Caesarea to see the governor. Even when others threatened his life, Paul continued to obey Jesus. He believed that God, who showed his love for the world by sending his son to die on the cross and rise again, would help him through hard times. We too can risk everything to share the gospel with courage because we know that God loves us and will care for us.
Hey, CityLine kids, it's time for a great session for you. Hey, I hope you join us on Sunday. That wasn't too good. As a matter of fact, I hope you join us on Sunday sometime because that would be a wonderful, great time for you. That would be good. But what I just did there, boy, that was bad. Sometimes things don't work out, do they, for us? Sometimes we think things are going to be good, and they turn out to be bad. Maybe sometimes you think things are going to be bad, and they turn out to be good. We have good and bad in our lives, right? Today, Paul is going to go through something that isn't really good. This story is in the Bible. It's in Acts, and I've got my Bible here, and you know what it's like to have a Bible. There's all kinds of stories in the Bible. Jesus walking on the water, Peter sinks in the water, the woman at the well, man, the Last Supper, and of course, Jesus on the cross. All these things are in the Bible. And you know, when we're reading along, we sometimes think, boy, that's a good thing that happened. But not everything in the Bible is good. And not everything that happens to you is good. That's right. Sometimes you go through hard times. I know I do. And those hard times, well, they're not really good at all. They don't help us to feel good about ourselves or our friends or our family. And sometimes maybe we feel like God has kind of left us. Have you ever read the Bible but you don't really see anything at all? Wow. And I mean, it's like you're looking for help but you can't find it. And maybe you think that God has left you. Wow. But you know what? The truth is, God's always there. He's always there for you. He was always there for me. and he's always there for Paul. And Paul never doubted that, even though a lot of good things happened to him. So remember, oh, look, everything's back. When you read the Bible, remember that God is always there for us, no matter what, even when we feel like, well, he's not there. Oh, it may appear that way, but guess what? God is always there. So let's put a smile on our face before I tell you this story today, because the story starts out in a very good way. As a matter of fact, Paul told people the good news about Jesus wherever he went. We know that, right? Paul was so excited to tell the good news. Well, that certainly was good. The good news is always good. But there were a lot of believers that believed. That was certainly good. Absolutely. And Paul got back to Jerusalem, his hometown, and there were so many people that were excited to see him. He'd been on all these journeys all over the place, and there were people that were excited to see him. And that was good. Wow, it was great. As a matter of fact, it was the best. Paul said hi to them again. I bet you he hugged them, and he said good things to them. But you know, there were a lot of people that were upset at Paul. And when he came back to Jerusalem, they said, why in the world are you telling Jews and Gentiles that they can have the same life without following rules? And remember, we talked about that. We talked about the fact that Jesus abolished the rules, and that what was important was not the rules of living every day or what you ate or what you did or whether you worked. But what was important was whether or not you had a relationship with Jesus in your heart. So they got angry. They were really upset at Paul. That was bad. Yep. It was really, really, really bad. And so they really wanted to stop Paul. They thought, boy, we have to stop him. We can't let him go on like this. And so Paul was at the temple, and a crowd of people dragged him away. And you know how angry they were? They were so angry, they wanted to kill him. That was very, very bad. Oh, my word. But you know what? He didn't get killed then. That was good, because a Roman official came and stopped them from doing any harm to Paul. And instead, they took Paul. So that was very good. That was very good that they stopped Paul from being killed. But they took Paul to the Sanhedrin. That was really bad. Now, do you know what the Sanhedrin was? Well, that was a group of Jewish leaders and a bunch of people that decided. Was sort of like a big group of people that decided whether or not Paul had broken any rules. It was really bad to stand before the Sanhedrin, because Paul had to defend himself, and he had to tell them, well, I don't think I did anything wrong. And that's exactly what Paul said. That was good. Paul said, friends, I have done what God wants me to do. That's very, very good, right? Absolutely. And I do not believe I have done anything wrong. Paul explained that he had been arrested, because that's what going in front of the Sanhedrin was bad. He had been arrested for helping people understand about Jesus, and that Jesus' resurrection gave hope. Jesus being born again or being rising again, amazing, so that we could be born again. He rose again, and that gives everybody hope. And it's for not just Jews, not just Gentiles, for everyone. That was really good. But then it got bad, because some men in the Sanhedrin started arguing, and they argued, well, resurrection doesn't happen now, and that happens later on. And they all disagreed. Some agreed with Paul, some didn't agree with Paul, and it was bad because it was a great big argument. My, oh my. So a good thing happened. The Roman soldiers took Paul away just to keep him safe. Well, that was really, really good. And good continued for Paul because God stood by him. Guess what? That was the time that God spoke to Paul. You know, sometimes things are not always going good for us, right? Sometimes things are going bad. So God spoke to Paul, and you know what he said? He said, have courage. I'm gonna show you something right here. This is amazing. I got four handkerchiefs. Yell the color out. Yep, that's green. Yell this one out. You got it. You didn't think you were just going to be able to sit there and not participate, right? Because we all have to participate together. Which this one? Yep, it's yellow. And how about this one? You got it. It is it's red. And absolutely, I'm going to throw it right here into this bag, and we're going to make everything come together. You know what the Bible says? The Bible says all things, everything work together for good. That's right. To them that love God and act according to his purpose. So we just need to apply God's word to our life, and things will come together. Isn't that right? So everything works together for what? Bad? No. Everything works together for good. Isn't that right? That's what the Bible says. So I bet you now it all happened. It's not magical. No, those are tricks. But God has the power to enable good things to happen in our life. It has nothing to do with magic tricks, not at all. So I think now we're, that's an egg. Okay. Well, I'm sorry. I don't know where that came from. But it's another egg. That's funny because all those handkerchiefs were supposed to work together and be one handkerchief, but they're gone. And there's eggs. Yeah, this is comical. I could have really good breakfast right now. You know what? I don't think this is good anymore. This is bad. This is not at all what I expected. There's another egg, and look at this. Oh my word! Nothing else. You know what? Sometimes even when we do the right thing, unexpected things happen. God never promises that things will go smooth for us all the time. He doesn't promise that everything will always work out well. It certainly didn't work out well for Paul. Absolutely not. Not all the time, because Paul had good times, but he also had bad times. Wait a second. But remember, this is what Christ does promise. What Jesus promises is that when we have faith, no matter what, and when we keep going, no matter what, Jesus will be there for us, just like he was there for Paul. And do you know what Jesus told Paul? He said, right when at the point when they were taking him away to keep him safe from the Sanhedrin arguing, Jesus said, have courage. Have courage. That's a very good thing. Have courage. Can you say that right now? Have courage. Yeah. No matter what, I want you to have courage. And this is what he told Paul. He said, you have spoken about me all over the place, in this town and that town. You've traveled on 3 missionary journeys, and you've talked about me in Jerusalem. Now, I want you to tell about me in Rome too. Wow. Is that amazing? That's a good thing. So Jesus didn't tell Paul to stop. He didn't tell him to give up. He didn't tell Paul, you know what? You know what? You can stop now because there's too much trouble. No. He told Paul to keep going. But he also said that no matter what happens, have courage because I am with you always, even to the end of the age. I don't care what you've gone through. Every time you cry, every time you're angry, every time you're frustrated, every time you're ready to hit something, every time you're feeling good, every time you're feeling bad, Jesus is saying to you, have courage. I've already been there. I know what's happening. I'm with you. And this may be a hard time, but I want you to go with me. Because all things work. Look at this. All things, wow, work together for good to them that love God and act according to his purpose. We put it all together, and that is a very good thing. So I want you to remember that now, the good and the bad. Paul had it both, had them both, but remember, he trusted God through it. Well, so it was a good thing that Jesus said, have courage. But then a very bad thing happened. The Jews decided they were going to kill Paul. That's right. They were going to kill him. And so they made a plan to get Paul, stop him, but not just get him and stop him, to kill him. That is a very bad thing. Wow. And so then, Paul's nephew heard about this plan. And as a matter of fact, some of the Jewish people said that they would not eat or drink until Paul was dead. Can you imagine that? That is some amazing anger. They wouldn't eat or drink until Paul was dead. That's a very bad thing. But Paul's nephew heard that, and that was good because he overheard the Jews, and he went to Paul, and he told Paul. And Paul said, oh my, now, if I were Paul, I would have said, I'm getting out of here. I got to get away because there's people that are trying to kill me. But Paul didn't say that. That was a good thing. He didn't even look at that threat as bad. Instead, he saw it as good. He saw it as a reason to stand up and show that God was Lord and Jesus was with him. Wow. So he told his nephew to tell the commanding officers that that was going to happen. And that was a good thing because they helped Paul. They moved him from where he was to Caesarea, and they got him there, and that was a very good thing. Our story ends there, but there will be more adventures with Paul. They may not all be good. Some of them may be bad, but it's just like the adventures that you have. Can you remember to put God first? Can you remember to allow God to work in your life, and all things, yeah, will work together for good? That is absolutely pretty amazing. Remember the Bible? Yeah. we spoke of it. We said that it's great to read the Bible when we're happy and feeling good, but sometimes if we're feeling bad or we think God's left us, we may not see clearly that he's really right there. Wow, that's right. And so I just want to remind you today that when you have courage, oh my, that's when things get really, really great. Oh, you go from good to great when you have courage. You go from good to great when you have faith. You go from good to great when you trust Jesus, even in your worst time. And then the Bible and your relationship with Christ, look, it will come to life. That is absolutely amazing. It will come to life. That's what the Bible does for us, what Jesus does for us. Oh, and I've got a great illustration for you here. It's about putting God first. So Paul had a lot of bad things happen, right? I call this like things of the world, you know, like getting sick and not having money and not getting all the things we want all the time. And maybe even our desire. We have a lot of desires, but that's not the most important thing in our life, what we want. This one here, well, this is amazing because this one stands for, others and ourselves right here. So here's what I'm going to do. I want you to watch closely. I'm going to do this. I'm going to put the materialism down on the bottom, and I'm going to take others and ourselves and put it right in the center. But this is God. The red sphere is God, and we may need to make God number one. Isn't that right? Absolutely. So we need to make God first in our lives, and when we do, well, that's when our relationship with God is the best it can be. And check it out. Uh-oh. Even though we tried to make God up here, he ended up down here. That's not really good, is it? No, absolutely not. And yet, we can try hard to get the things we want, the things we need. That's not the most important thing, right? We need to get that right down on the bottom, right where it belongs. Check it out. What do we have left? Others and ourselves. Because others and ourselves are more important than things. Isn't that right? Absolutely. So let's put that in. And then God has to always be on top. And when God's on top, that's amazing too. Check it out. Now we got it. I think we did it. We tried hard, we prayed a little bit, we had a little bit of faith, but then maybe something went bad, and look, it didn't work out the way we expected. Now, we're still on top, others and ourselves are up on top, but there's God right in between others and ourselves and the things we want and need. God moved up a notch. That's a great place to be. But he wants to be Lord of our life. He wants to be on top. And there's no doubt about that. God needs to be up on top. If there's an empty space in your life, then I want you to remember that God needs to be on top. Sometimes I think you and I, we do this. We cover God up. You know, and when we need him, we go get him. Like if we're sick, we go get God. If we need some help, we go get God. When we go to church, we bring God with us. When we go to school, well, we might cover him up. When we see our friends, we do the things that they want to do. Not necessarily the things that God wants us to do. And so we may cover ourselves, cover God up, and we just act on our own. But God wants to be there no matter what. He told Paul to have courage. So I want you to have courage. And remember this, God won't stay covered up in our lives. Nope, not at all. He doesn't want to be third place. He doesn't want to be second place, but he needs to be first place. Wow. You can make God number one. Absolutely wonderful when you let him be Lord of your life. That's what Paul did. And remember, have courage. Hope we'll see you soon. Love you, City Line kids. Jesus, thank you for giving us the right to have courage. You ask us to have courage. And even though good times are happening and bad times are happening, we know that you're with us through it all. So help us give everything we can to you. Help us to put you first and remember to have courage, because you've been there before and you'll help us through even the worst of times. Thanks for helping Paul, and we look forward to you helping us. We pray these things in the name of Jesus, and you said where you are.
Hi there, I'm Pastor Brian, and it's time for Questions from Kids. Jace from West Frankfort, Illinois asks,
why do some people want others to stop sharing good news about Jesus?
Jace, that is a fantastic question. You know, we see this in the Bible story today when some people wanted to stop Paul from telling others about Jesus. We've also seen it earlier. People did the same thing. They tried to keep Peter quiet. Even in the Gospels, people tried to stop Jesus himself from sharing how we can be saved and know God personally. So why? Why did people do it then? Why do people do it now? So at the core here, what I think is going on is that people, when they're confronted by Jesus, it forces them to look within themselves and realize that they are not following him. They've not trusted in him. And that really makes them uncomfortable. And I think when they're confronted with the truth, and God is true, and they're confronted with that truth, the way they defend themselves because they're not ready to follow Jesus is they push back against him. And so it's really a defense mechanism on a lot of people's thought. I think that is really at the core of what is going on here. And so when people push back and they try to keep us quiet from telling others about Jesus, I don't think we should see them as enemies, as hostile toward us. I think we should see them with sympathy, with compassion, with love, because they're missing it. They're missing the truth. They've not trusted in Jesus, and they desperately need to hear about God and about how they can be saved through Jesus so they can come to know him. So to me, I think when we respond in situations like this, it should be through that, with compassion and with a heart to care about that person who's trying to keep us quiet. So here's a question back for you. How could you respond to someone who doesn't want to hear what you have to say about Jesus?